love the Lord, shout a big amen. Oh, come on. If you love the Lord, shout a strong amen. If you love the Lord, shout a strong amen. Let's lift our hands to heaven, give Him praise, give Him glory, give Him honor, give Him adoration. Exalt the name of the Lord, extol our God because He's mighty. Exalt our God because He's faithful. Exalt our God because there is no life unto Him. The Lord who kept us in January, preserved us in February, kept us in March, brought us over. Yes, in the month of April, the Lord who stood by us all through May, the Lord who preserved and protected us in the month of June, the Lord God Jehovah, who was our deliverer in the month of July, the Lord who strengthened us all through August, the one who preserved us in the month of September, and now He has graciously brought us to the 10th month. I'd like you to lift up your voice, don't boast, don't be quiet, lift up your voice, give Him praise over every member of your household, give Him praise over every member of this congregation. Thank Him for His preservation. Thank Him no death amongst us. Thank Him no shame amongst us. Thank Him for His goodness. Thank Him for His eternal kindness. Only Him and Him alone could have kept us. In spite of the destruction that is upon the face of the earth, He has been good to us. He has kept us by His graciousness. Lift up your voice and bless the Lord. Don't keep quiet. Don't keep quiet. Don't keep quiet. Don't keep quiet. Go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead. Lift up your voice clearly. Lift up your voice. Lift it up with strength. Give Him praise. Give Him glory. Give Him honor. Give Him adoration. Father, we thank You. Our good God, we exalt You. You have been a good Father. You have kept us. You have stood by us. You have blessed us. You have fortified us. You have been gracious to us. You have kept us and our children. You have not allowed us to be afflicted. You have not allowed us to be harassed. You have not allowed us to be disgraced. Our hands can move. Our mouth can speak. Yes, our legs can walk. We are not bedridden. We are not arrested by coronavirus because of You, O God. Not because of our hand sanitizers. Not because of social distancing. Not because of our mask. But because of Your covering. Because of Your grace. Lord, we return to Your altar to say thank You, Jesus. To say thank You for Your message. To say thank You for Your grace. Only the living can praise the Lord. Thank You for keeping us alive. We bless Your name, our Father. We give You all the glory. To You belong all the praise. To You belong all the glory. To You belong all the honor. To You belong all the adoration. To You belong thanksgiving. To You belong dominion. To You belong worship. To You belong government. To You belong greatness. We ascribe every greatness to our God because He's good. And all His ways are just. He's the God of all faithfulness. Without injustice, truth and uprightness, we give You praise, Jehovah. Thank You, Almighty God. In Jesus' mighty name, we are free. What a mighty God You are. Hallelujah, what a mighty God You are. Thank you. place to kneel down, or you can find a place to lie down. I want you to go ahead and give all the glory to the Lord. I want you to honor Him. I want you to just show to Him that you appreciate Him. From the depth of your heart, go ahead, go ahead. Let's thank Him for keeping us. This is the 10th month. Only His mercies could have kept us. Only His goodness could have kept us. Only His grace could have kept us. Only His mercies could have kept us. He has kept us. He has kept our children. Oh God, we are grateful. 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 Keeper of Israel, we are grateful. Mighty God of Jacob, we are grateful. Our deliverer, we are grateful. The God of Jeshua, we are grateful. The one that has not dealt with us according to our sins, according to our hell. For if thou Lord shouldest mark iniquity, who shall stand? Lord, we are here, Lord, today because of your mercies, because of your goodness, because of your graciousness. Oh Lord, we acknowledge you. We honor you, O God. Thank you for this house. Thank you for our pastor. Thank you for his family. Thank you for every family in the house. We give you praise, Jehovah. Please accept our thanks to the glory of your name. Thank you, Jehovah God. In Jesus' mighty name, we have given thanks. Father, we just bow before you. If we were to have 1,000 tongues, it would still not be enough to thank you for your goodness to us. As the people who have understanding, we have come to your house to say thank you. Please accept our thanks. Over our children, we say thank you. Over our young adults, we say thank you. Over our old ones, we say thank you. Over this church, Lord, we say thank you. For Johnny Messing, we say thank you. For this great conference, we say thank you. For all your visitations, we say thank you. It is not about us, it is about you. It is about your mercy. It's about your power. It is about your glory. It's about what you can do. It is not about a guest minister. It is not about a preacher. It's about Jesus the crucified, who died and rose again, who is alive forevermore, who is mighty to save, mighty to heal, mighty to deliver. So Lord, we bow before you. Please let your name be exalted. Do that which only you can do now. I will be careful to return to you all the glory. Thank you, gracious Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we are prayed. If you love the Lord, say be your amen. Amen. If you love the Lord, say be your amen. Amen. If Jesus has been good to you, say be your amen. Hallelujah. You may please have your seats in Jesus' name. I appreciate God for our pastor and our mother in the house. We thank God for your works of faith, for your labor of love, and we pray that grace will be on the increase over you and over your ministry in Jesus' mighty name. And I appreciate everyone in the house today. Everybody lifting up their hands, supporting them in prayers. Every worker, every minister, every member, everybody that is sacrificing in one way or the other to push the work of God forward in this assembly, I join faith with you that your own life will go forward. Oh, come and say your life will go forward. You will go from glory to glory, from strength to strength. You will never have a better yesterday in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Okay, I will pray that prayer one more time. I say, you will never have a better yesterday. In the name of Jesus Christ, it is well with you. Hallelujah. It's good, so good to be with us. The last time I came was over 2 years. And I thank God for the privilege of being back in the house. Hallelujah. Amen and amen. So I've been asked to speak with on Divine Intimacy. It's our intimacy conference. And I thank God for the team that we have chosen, and I thank God for having in the house a pastor that loves God and loves God's people and who wants his people to grow.
the greatest space in my life and in your life is the space of drawing closer to Jesus. And if there's anything that must be your prayer and that must be my prayer, that must be our pursuit, is to know him more and more. That is a song we used to sing in those days. He said, that I may know him, 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 and his power and the power, and the power, oh, and the power of resurrection, and the power, and the power of resurrection, that I may know him, 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 and the power, and the
I'm
problems are really not what we think they are. Our real problem is our relationship with the Lord. A woman sang a song not too long ago. She said, "The person who has not seen you has not seen anything. The person who has not known you has not known anything. The person who does not have you does not have anything." That's our real problem. So the purpose of church is to steer a Honda and to steer a drive in you towards meeting your real problem in life. Your real problem is not a new car. Your real problem is not your mortgage. It's not changing your address. That's not your real problem. Your real problem is not what you drive, it's what drives you. Your real problem is not your zip code. Your real problem is not whether you live in a shanty or you live in downtown or you live in a penthouse. That is not your real problem. The real problem is our relationship with God. And blessed is that pastor, and blessed is that person who has identified the real problem and is wanting to address those problems headlong. Our real problem is not our designers. A lot of people wear designers, but they don't know the design of God for their lives. Our real problem is not our wardrobe. Our real problem is the spiritual garment that we put on. Our real problem is our intimacy with God. So that man, that headmistress, that headmaster taught us long ago, back then in high school, said, "Day by day, dear Lord, three things I pray. To see you more clearly," because a lot of us, we have vision problems. Vision is not just capturing the things that lie in the spiritual. Vision is seeing things the way God sees them. Vision is the ability to keep the big things of life big and the small things of life small. Vision is having the right perspective and the right adjustment about your needs in life. So today, let's talk for a few minutes about the need for spiritual intimacy. The need for you and I to get closer with God. See a scripture with me in Genesis chapter 18. Genesis 18, I'll read from verse 17 to verse 19. Now, this is the testimony of God concerning Abraham. Genesis 18, I read from verse 17 all the way to verse 19. Now, it said, "And the Lord said, shall I hide from Abraham that thing which I do, seeing that Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him. For I know him, that he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he had spoken of him." Now, God gave a testimony about Abraham. God said, "Shall I hide from Abraham that which I am doing?" Now, this is the mighty Almighty himself speaking. God said, "I'm coming to do something in Manassas." And God said, "Shall I hide from my people in Grace Assembly what I am doing?" God said, "I have a program to deliver, and it will be unjust if I hide it from my friend." That is intimacy. That God wants to do something in your family, and somehow you got to know about it. Himself is asking himself, with the way this son and daughter of mine, with the way he relates with me, it will be unjust
for me to hide things from him. When you are intimate with God, you come to the place of divine revelation. When you have intimacy, you don't live by accident, you live by design. God said, will I hide from Abraham? My brother, my sister, blessed are you when God, when you get to that level in your walk with God, that God said, no. This man is my friend. I have things that I'm doing on the earth. I can't hide from him because he has that intimacy with me. So what is intimacy? I know that a lot of people have spoken over this weekend, and I know they have defined and explained intimacy under different nuances, and you know, so but let me just assume and say some things about intimacy. So what is intimacy? When we talk about intimacy, we are talking about a close and affectionate relationship between two people. When we talk about intimacy, we are talking about a close and an affectionate relationship between two people. Intimacy has to do with affection. It has to do with closeness. When we talk about intimacy, we are talking about a close association or a detailed knowledge. A detailed knowledge or a deep understanding about a person or about a subject matter. When I say you are very intimate or you are very familiar with Manassas, I'm saying that you know the streets, you know your way around, you know where to turn. If there were to be traffic, you know where to take. You can either go southbound or northbound, and you say, well, let's go this way because this is my city. This is where I live. Why? Because you are intimate, you are familiar, you have a deep and a detailed understanding about the city. Somebody get one person across here. So when we say somebody is intimate, we are saying that you, in fact, have a detailed understanding. Number three, what do we mean when we talk about intimacy? We are talking about closeness. We are talking about togetherness. We are talking about affinity. We are talking about attachment. We are talking about inwardness, experience, friendship in a superior level. We are talking about something that has gone beyond the natural. We are talking about warmth. We are talking about understanding. We are talking about communion. And we are talking about confidence. That is what intimacy means. So when we talk about intimacy, we are talking about the level of confidence, the level of amity, the level of affection, the level of communion and confidence that you have with someone. So to be intimate with God, it means that you are a friend of God. When you are intimate with God, it means you are in love with God. It means you are affectionate about God. You just love God. You are just affectionate about the things of God. You just love God. Every time you hear about you, every time you hear about the things of God, your heart is drawn. It means that you are attached to God. Paul said, what shall separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus? When you are intimate with God, that is an attachment between you and God. Someone who is intimate with God knows that without God he is nothing, and with God he is everything. When you are intimate with God, it means that you have a deep knowledge of God. The problem we have in church is that a lot of people know about God, but they don't know God. They know about God. In fact, when they sing the hymns, before you sing the last time, they help you sing it. They know about God, but they don't know God. When you are quoting a scripture, before you finish it, they quote it. They say, okay. In fact, they help you analyze it. Say, he has not said that one. He has not said that one. But he's still a thief. He's still a fornicator. He's still immoral. He's still wayward. He's still abusive. He still fights his wife. He still backbites. He still injurious. Alright? He knows church language, but he doesn't have church life. And that's the problem that we have. There are a lot of people, they have a superficial, if you would, knowledge of God. And God wants for you and I to take our lives deeper. I see grace coming upon you this weekend. Amen. Oh, come on, I see grace coming upon you this weekend. Amen. I see grace coming upon you this weekend. In the name of Jesus Christ. You see, the one of the first churches I ever pastored, back there in Nigeria in the state. That time I had a friend who happened to be a deacon. And we were planning for an outreach. So we began to plan for the outreach, and we wanted to take the flyers to different ministries so that they can distribute. So we took this flyer somewhere, and I just said, oh, since this is the government quarters, this is around the secretariat, so let me quickly drop some with our dear deacon so that deacon can help us distribute it. So we got there, and I got to the office. I said, I'm looking for deacon so-so-so-and-so. Then the man looked at me and said, who do you say you are looking for? I said, deacon so-so-so-and-so. He said, sorry, in this office there is no deacon. I said, am I in the wrong building? Or maybe I got to the wrong. I said, no, you have been here. This is office. He said, I'm sorry, there is no deacon here. So while I was saying that, then somehow the brother came out from another office and came in. I said, oh, my pastor. I said, hey, this is the person I'm looking for. Then the man looked at me and said, so you are thinking. Ah. He said, you are thinking, I must be Pope. He said, did you just say Dicky or demon? If you are a Dicky, I must be Pope. You know why? He knows about God, but he doesn't know God. And I thank God that that brother got that challenge, because that was the beginning of the transformation of his life. The world, the people of the world, they know the people that are intimate with God. You see, the people of the world, they don't have problem with God. They have problem with us. The reason they don't come to church is not because they hate God, but they hate our lies. They hate our hypocrisy. It's not God. They don't have problem with God. They love God. They know they need God. But the problem is that those of you who say you are close to God, when they see the fruit, the hatred that is in your life, the way you backbite the person that helped you, the person that brought you here and sustained you, the way you marshaled that person, they see it and say, if you say you are a deacon, I must be Pope. That's why they don't come. Pastor, will you invite me next time? That's the reason why they don't come. So the greatest challenge for you and I is not just to know about God, but to truly know God. It's not to be religious, but to be spiritual. The greatest gap is not more activities, it's more accuracy. Challenge is not for more anointing, but for better alignment. For you and I to align our lives and our ways with God. And look at me very well. What I say to you, I say to myself. I'm not preaching at you. I'm telling you that we have a problem, every one of us. And only God can help us when we truly draw near and say, God, do something with my life. I say, God, I truly want to be genuine, that I may know you and the power of your resurrection and the fellowship of your suffering. To see you more clearly, to truly love you more dearly, and to follow you more nearly, day by day. A lot of people who are intimate with God in scriptures, you read about Enoch. The Bible says that Enoch walked with God and was not, because
God took him. Genesis 5 and verse 24. You see that Elijah was also very intimate with God. Elijah was the type of man that will say, as the Lord lives, before whom I stand, there shall be no rain or dew these days, except at my word. You see, authority, spiritual authority, comes from the place of intimacy with God. For you to decree and for heaven to say amen to it, it doesn't come. When we were on campus back there in Nigeria in those days, I had a friend who likes to dress like Pastor Adewale. Those were the days when Gio was still wearing Adire. How many of you know those days? See the way you are looking at me. How many of you know those days when Gio wear Adire? Thank you, sir. And he wear one short Adire, and he will wear normal pant, and he will put his tambourine. And we want to talk to millions of people, and we just come there casually, and you see the power of God moving. So my friend also thought that by wearing a delay. So and I called there and said, Bros, let's get this thing right. You are not Gio. You look. Multiply the delay. It doesn't need the big power. I said, Bros, those of us who wear jeans and our t-shirts. And he will put his tambourine too, and he will be walking like this, like somebody that. I said, Bros, stop that nonsense. A lot of you know history. You can tell us how we move from a butemeta to this one to that one, and that's all you know. No power. Because you are a historian, but you are not intimate. The authority of Elijah comes from the fact that he was standing before God. And he could tell Ahab and say, before whom I stand, there shall be no rain nor dew except at my word. And God will say amen. Why? Because he had come to the place of authority with God. If somebody gets my passing across to us, you see that in 1 Kings 17 and verse 1. What do you say about Samuel? God said, listen, come out of your Bibles, come to the altar. In 1 Samuel chapter 3 from verse 2 to 7, you see that God did not allow the words of Samuel to fall to the ground. Why? Because he was intimate with God. When the sons of Eli, the Ophni and the Phineas of his life, when they were doing their stuff, he kept maintaining and investing in his relationship with God. My brother, my sister, I didn't come to harass you today. I came with just one purpose. That you will leave this meeting today, and this meeting will make you to fall in love again with Jesus. And to fall in love with your purpose in life. That this meeting will drive you back to your closet. That it will drive you back to prayers. That it will drive you back to studying the word. That it will drive you back to the place where you can have a stand among them that stand before the Lord. And you can go back to the closet and begin to realign your priorities. And begin to take your relationship with God serious. That's my goal. And I tell you, I don't need 1 hour to do what I need to do. Once I'm done, I'll leave this pulpit and I want you to cry out to the Lord. Look, you can be fanciful and useless. And you can be old school and powerful, depending on your relationship with God. Depending on your relationship with God. Our problem is that packaging has taken away the power of the cross from us. Our problem is that somehow the technology that's supposed to enhance our capacity has become a god instead of the true and the living God. Samuel, God did not allow his word to fall to the ground. Why? Because he was intimate with God. What about Daniel? What do you say about Daniel? Oh, the
man that refused to defile himself. Daniel chapter 1 verse 8. Because he was so intimate with God. And he didn't want to lose his consecration. He had a kingdom consciousness. He maintained his identity as an Israelite, even in Babylon. He was faultless and blameless in his civil service. He had an unbroken fellowship in the face of threats. He had the ability and the courage and the energy to stand for God in a foreign land. No wonder his life was filled with exploits. He had different encounters. He was living in the Old Testament, but he was living in the power of the age to come. Do you know that before Revelation came, the book of Revelation, Daniel was already operating in Revelation? Because he was intimate with God. He was intimate with God. But let me talk about one person, and I begin to tie this together for you. Abraham was the man that was called the friend of God. See something with me in James chapter 2. James chapter 2 and verse 23. Everybody turn there. James chapter 2 and verse 23. When you come to church, three things must be opened. Your heart must be opened. Your Bible must be opened. And your notes must be opened. James chapter number 3. Just chapter number 2. I see something in verse 23. James 2 and verse 23. Let's read it together. Let's go. Every one of us, let's read it together. One, two, more. And the scripture was fulfilled, which said, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness. For he was called the what? Oh, talk to me, John. He was called the what? The friend of God. Abraham was called the friend of God. No wonder God said, how can I come to Abraham's city and not let Abraham know? Because he's my friend. How many of you have been to New York? Let me see your hand raised up. How many of you have friends in New York? Let me see your hand. How many of you feel something that, oh, when you come to New York, you must see your friend? At least, like, how can I come to the city? Now, Manhattan is very busy. Brooklyn is a long place to drive to. Queens is filled up and jam-packed. And then Staten Island is far away. But you tell yourself, how can I be in that city and not see my friend? That was exactly what happened. God was going to Sodom and Gomorrah. And God said, how can I go to Sodom and Gomorrah without telling my friend? When it becomes as if the Almighty himself owes you, that the Almighty himself takes, God said, no. And it will be unjust because he is my friend. Because he's my friend. How much to develop your relationship to that level where there will be a divine condescending, that the Almighty himself will condescend to your level. God will come down to your level and say, how can I pass through this place without letting my friend know? And God comes to you in the dream and say, no, something is going to happen next week. But it comes to you as a revelation to say something is going to happen, but prepare yourself. Don't take that out. And some other Christians who are not friends of God, they will go through it and fall into temptation. But because you have developed an intimacy with God, God said, it is impossible because he is a friend of God. The Bible says he was called the friend of God. I don't know about you, that's my prayer. That's my desire. You see, I don't want you to just be singing the song, I am a friend of God. Some people are enemies of God, they're singing the song, I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me his friend. I don't say, who is talking? Come back. talking. You, my friend, I know you not. Because, and he says, I am a worker. God said, yes, he's a worker. But he's a worker of iniquity. So it's not enough for us to just say, I am a friend of God. You are the one saying, you are a friend of God. Can everyone acknowledge you as such? This is the testimony that God gave about Abraham. God said it was that righteousness was imputed into him, and he was called the friend of God. Ah, Yakatabosamatosh. See something in 2 Chronicles chapter 20 and verse 7. 2 Chronicles 20 and verse 7. That God will be able to testify about us that indeed we are his friends. And sir, if God can give that testimony about me, I am it. That's all I want. That God can say, look, I'm not just talking about redemption. Yes, redemption means us the friend of God, I'll get there. But that God indeed can say, there is somebody who is my friend, and I cannot go to his city without visiting him first. Look at 2 Chronicles 20 and verse 7. Let's read it together. One, two, go. Art not thou our God, who did drive out the inhabitants of this land before thy people Israel, and gave us it to the seed of Abraham, thy friend forever. Another place where God, the Bible testifies about the intimacy of Abraham. Inhabitants of this land before thy people Israel, and givest it to the seed of Abraham, thy friend forever. That's the second place in the Bible that God will testify that Abraham was his friend. Look at it. Isaiah 41 and verse 8. Isaiah 41 verse 8. Please go there with me. Thank you, sir. Let's read Isaiah 41 verse 8 together. Let's read it. It's on the screen. One, two, go. But thou, Israel, art my son, Jacob, whom I have chosen, the seed of Abraham, my friend. The third time. Out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, every matter is established. Three times, sir. God said, Abraham is what? He's my friend. Now, the word my friend in that place, from the Hebrew word, is called the El Kali. El Kali is the personal friend of God. Abraham was God's El Kali. He had become an El Kali, a personal friend of God, not a casual friend of God, not a professing friend of God. But he had become the Hel Kali. Somebody say Hel Kali. Oh, come on, let me hear you. Say Hel Kali. Say one more time. Say Hel Kali. He had become an Hel Kali, a personal friend of God. And may you come to that place where you become a personal friend of God. And what is the implication of being an Hel Kali? What is the implication? Number one, I'll tell you seven things and I'll pray with you. The first thing is that, you see, friendship or intimacy creates a measure of equality between the persons concerned. Sir, what's your name, sir? Huh? You see, he's a religious man. He put brother immediate. So that just so you know, that is a brother of Christ. Now, brother, do you have people that are your friend that you are older than? Yes. But because you are friends, what happened? You remove that distance of age. Is that not true? And you can communicate freely. You have people that you are way older than. Socially, you are better than them. But because friendship presupposes a type of condescending and a type of equality. So because Abraham was the friend of God, it was as though Abraham and God began to relate on the same page. Now, God is still the Almighty. The mighty Almighty by himself. But God came down to the level of Abraham. And that was why Abraham can negotiate with God. Oh dear, it is so. That's why Abraham could negotiate with God. Have you seen somebody as your, let me use an example. Maybe you wanted to deal with somebody. And somebody came here and said, oh no, 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 no. And you look at that person and say, if not because of this person, I should have dealt very strongly with you. But because of this person that got involved, you are pardoned. That was the type of condescending that came between Abraham and God. Solomon should have been he should have been, in fact, there should have been nobody. Abraham began to negotiate. I said, Papa, I know now. Okay, what if there are 50 people there? Will you still destroy the place? God said, no. Then Abraham went again and said, okay, what if there are less than 50? What if there are less than 20? God said, no. What is there? Okay, sir, please. Don't be annoyed. Let me speak just this once. What if there are less than 20? Then he held on to God and said, shall the judge of the heart fool on? You see, you can never know a correct prayer life until you come to intimacy with God. Prayer will be a burden until you have a true intimacy with God. And Abraham began to negotiate. I held on to the hand of God. And the man assured and said, well, Lot and his wife and his children and their in-laws, they should have been able to convert maybe one or two other persons. So there should be 10 people at least in Sodom. He was negotiating with God. Why? Because God came down to his level. There was a man called Kenneth E. again. He died some 17 years ago. And at the time, Kenneth E.'s wife had a breast cancer. And so Eke began to pray. He prayed for his wife. And God came to Eke and said, you know what? By destiny, my daughter is supposed to come home this time. That this is the time for her to die. That by destiny, by divine design, this was the time he was meant to die. He said, but because you have prayed, I've added years to her life. You know what? Hagin's wife died after Hagin had died himself. Because an El Kali, a personal friend of God, interceded, and God listened to him. Number two, when you're a friend of God, you have unbroken fellowship. Intimacy. Fellowship begets intimacy. Number three, intimacy begets revelation. The resultant effect of fellowship is that divine secrets will be downloaded to you. The Lord gave Abraham a revelation about is planned for the nations of the earth. You see that in Genesis 17, 6 to 7. An intimate person can know the plan of God around the world. The Lord revealed to Abraham the birth of Isaac and his plan to make Isaac the covenant carrier of the redemption plan of God for mankind. Because of his intimacy, God revealed his mind to Abraham about Sodom and Gomorrah. Number four, intimacy births covenant. Because of the intimacy that Abraham had with God, the Bible says, the Lord made a covenant with Abraham. Give me Genesis 15 and verse 18, please. Genesis 15 and verse 18. Thank you. Let's read that scripture, every one of us. Let's read it one to go. In the same day, the Lord made a covenant with Abraham, saying unto thy seed, have I given this land, from the river of Egypt unto the great river, even the river Euphrates. God made a covenant with Abraham. You see, your intimacy with God is what makes you to have a personal covenant with God. Let me tell you something that happened to me when I was graduating from university. Back then in Nigeria, I was pastor from year 1 to year 4. I didn't fail. By the mercy of God, I was what you call the dean student. By the mercy of God, what you call the dean student in your home area, that was what I was. I led my class. I did very well. When I was going to the university, my father looked at me. One day I was doing a study and I was writing some things and I haven't had admission that time. So my dad looked at me. My dad happened to be a secondary school principal. I come from a family of teachers. You know, and he saw me reading and I was doing series of study, the Holy Spirit in the life of Peter. And so my dad came to my room to check what I was doing. And he saw that I had been busy all day. And he just passed by, hello. And he thought, so when he now, just to check what I was doing, and he saw the notes that I've made, his spirit sank. So he looked at me this way, he said, he mentioned my name 3 times. He said, Morakio. 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 If you can give 1/3 of your time to your books. He said, I know you will be the university student. He said, just 1/3. He said, the devotion you give to religion, if you can give 1/3 of your time, the devotion you give to prayers, my mom is in my house as I speak, and we were just talking about as a teenager, I will go to church 6 a.m. and come back 6 p.m. And you know what? I was not sleeping. I was praying in the Holy Ghost as a teenager. Knock on myself by mercy. Sometimes it takes me 3 days to read the entire New Testament. Just knock on myself. Take it water only. Just study. Just read it. Just study. Just read it. I'll take megaphone. You know what they call megaphone? 5 a.m. I'm on the street. And by Jesus, and by 6 a.m., I'm back to the church. I lock up myself. I learned to pray when I didn't have prayer points. I went to the mountain. Stayed there. Sun will come. Rain will come. I didn't even have prayer points. There was no needs in my life. I was building my intimacy with God. Listen, intimacy with God is not what you build because you have problems. Not because you are looking for the fruit of the womb. Not because you are looking for a contract. That's not what makes you to develop a relationship with God. A lot of us, what is motivating us is fear. It is not love. So my dad said, if you would give one-third of your time. So I told my dad that the assessment. I cannot promise that I will not do evangelism and stuff when I get to campus. I said, but one thing I can assure you, if I come back home with less than a 2-1, I said, sir, please send me back. He said, I will hold you to that. I said, yes, sir. So I was pastor from first year to the last year. And I made a good grade. I don't know what I needed to get. And so the last day or the last week that I had to spend on campus, that time I submitted what they call project and everything, submitted my thesis, and I began to pray. I said, God, I've done your will. Please don't let me go to the labor market. Let me go to the favor market. I went to pray and said, God, please make a way for me. Grant me a job. I don't want to stay at home. And I was fasting all through the week. I started my fast. Monday, I'll go to the sports center. I pray. Then I will go back home in the evening. I'll get back to the sports center. And I begin to pray again. And on the third day, God spoke to me. I heard God. May you hear God today. You see, a problem remains a problem until you have heard from God. So I began to pray and I said, God, make a way for me. Then God said, keep quiet. God told me clearly, he said, there is nobody that serves me with their youth that I will abandon in their hard of life. Amen. He said, I am a faithful God. He said, I shall go with you. And may I say this to you? That was the certificate I took out of school. I have a PhD. It's not my PhD that is feeding me. It's the word from God that is sustaining me. I have 3 master's degrees. But that is not the strength of my life. The strength of my life is the covenant. Look, when you are under a covenant, things may look hard, but somehow God will make a way for you. Things may become difficult, but somehow Jehovah will make a way for you. Every other system can shut down, but the covenant of God never shuts down. Every other thing can fail, but the word from God cannot fail. If you are under the sea, the word of God will make a way for you. If you are in the desert, the word of God will make you to flourish. Yes, if you are in the midst of a battle, the word of God will be beside your battle. If you are in the midst of a crisis, the word of God will make sure that you land on the other side. If you are in the midst of darkness, and everything you see is darkness, your covenant with God will make sure that a light will shine in your darkness. If somebody gets what I'm passing across to you, what you need is your intimacy with God. When you have a covenant with God and come to the place where you become an helper, you will have nothing to fear. Open your eyes and look at me. The reason why we speak with so much certainty is not because we have a fat bank account. It's not because we have any huge connection. It's not even because we have the details of the economy. The reason why we speak with so much faith and boldness is because we know we have a relationship with God. I've tasted battles. I've seen issues. I've tasted the unfair side of life. But one thing I can tell you, that is a God who makes a way. Amen. It's a God who makes a way. At a time, maybe I said it the last time I came. My wife studied in Britain. She was doing fine. Everything was okay. And at the time, all manner of crisis just broke out with her health. All manner of crisis. I mean, all manner. And for those who care to listen, I married my wife a virgin. And the doctor looked at us and said, your chances of ever having a child is 0.1. And later, he said, with time, things were decreasing. And I wake up at night and I say, oh my God, there is only one thing I know how to do, and that's to pray. And sometimes we come out in the middle of the night and I will pace back and forth with a song on my lips. What can he not do? What can he not do? He makes the heaven and the earth. What can he not do? Sometimes my wife woke me in the middle of the night and said, man of God, pray for me. Said the other person you prayed for gave a testimony. This other one gave a testimony. One day we were in church, man. You know the way we were in church. And a small child was just gravitating towards me. That child just wanted me. Was just so I decided to carry the child. Then the mother of the child came forward. We were at a power explosion or something. Then the mother of the child came forward. And the father. And they wanted to kneel down. I was like, oh, what's going on? Said, can you remember us? I said, I can't. Then the man said, you came to our church. So yeah. New Wine Assembly. You came to minister. I was the lady you called out and prayed over. We've been married for 4 years and no conception. Said, that's a month. We conceived, and this is the child. Said, no wonder the child was gravitated to. And you know what? I wish my wife, when I went, I was the only one that went. And I wish my wife was not sitting next to me. My wife was so, the woman carried, said, this is your child. I put the child on my laps. And of course, my wife, you know, and when we got into the car, I said, ah, this is your own anointing, your gargon. It seemed to work. It seemed to walk outside. He said, please, you must lay hands on me. So you must lay hands on me. I said, I will even lay hands on you. I said, if I have control over this thing, I will lay everything on you and give you 3 so that you can leave me alone. So, this is your anointing. Oh, God, no. Only was it, yeah. And I'll go out in the middle of the night. My wife sometimes will tap me and say, you are not sleeping. He said, I'm just wondering when this dryness will be over. Then I said, shut up in the name of the Lord. There is no dryness here. So the Lord has said to me that you will embrace a child. Not just embrace one, we embrace two, we embrace three till you are tired. So don't think there are all sin challenges. But the fruit of a life of intimacy with God is a confidence. But if you are going through challenges today, the other side, you will celebrate. Yeah. Someone else is complaining. Oh, this child is all over me. I said, be careful, no. Be careful. The other time, you said, this you are anointed. You have seen now that my anointing produced, people will be jumping all over the house, scattering the thing. I said, that anointing is as active as me. This is the proof. Oh. What can you not do? The God who made the heaven and the earth. When you come to that place of confidence, where you have a relationship with God. Today I want you to pray a prayer. What makes fear to die in your life is your intimacy with God. What makes you to stop being fearful? It's getting crazy out there. What makes you not to lose your peace or lose your sleep is your relationship with God. I'd like everybody here to stand to their feet today. And I want you to pray a prayer. Lift up your two hands to heaven. Lord, draw me closer to you. Lift up your hands. Lift up your hands. Whatever is standing as a hindrance, whatever is standing as a barrier, don't keep quiet. Don't keep quiet. This is not a time to keep quiet. Everybody lift up your hands to heaven. Whatever makes you to be afraid, whatever is standing between you and God, ask God for mercy today. Father, draw me close to you to see you more clearly, to love you more dearly, to follow you more intimately. That is where I stand. That is my desire. Everybody, don't anywhere you are. This is not the time to keep quiet. Open your mouth. Open your mouth. Open your mouth. You are the back. Open your mouth. Open your mouth. Lift up your hands. Pray. Lord, lift, draw me closer to you, Lord. In the name of Jesus. That I may know you and the power of your resurrection and the fellowship of your suffering be made conformable to your death. Lord, bring us closer. Bring us closer. Bring us closer. Bring us closer. Bring me closer to you. Lift up your voice. Lift up your voice. Don't keep quiet. Don't keep quiet. That teenager, speak up, speak up. Don't keep quiet. Lord, draw me closer to you, Lord. Every one of us, bring us to the place of intimacy that we may know you, Lord. Bring us closer in our heart. Let there be humility. Let there be submission in the name of Jesus. Every arrogance, every pride, every lust, everything that is standing between us and destiny, Father, take them away in the mighty name of Jesus. Yes, Lord, that we may know you and the power of your resurrection. Jesus of Nazareth, be real to me. Be real to me. Be real in my life. Be real in my home. Be real in your power in the name of Jesus. Be real to me. It's not about my problem. It's about my intimacy. Let me become an El Kali, a personal friend of God. Let me become an El Kali. Maka parogo shata. Suka palama shaka lekete. 2 more minutes. Lift up your voice. 2 more minutes. Sheka malaba robo kedega satabash. Zebrele mokobo soka palaba gaya. 2 more minutes. 2 more minutes. Lift up your voice. Pray, 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 pray. Pray like thunder. Pray, 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 pray. Pray, pray. Lift up your 2 hands, everybody. Lift up your 2 hands. I see the Holy Ghost coming on you. I see the power of God coming on you. Lift up your 2 hands. Ikapalaba sakata yabalatos. Sheke palomo sokata yalimokos. Jabralaba kosotele. Jebreke malobo kosotele badia. Shabale peleme kesete baliketeleba. Sukata la pele kete babolobo ketele. Jebreke teka malaba kasakata. Jebrele bakabo sopale ketele kebaba. Holy Ghost, come afresh upon me. The power of the Lord, come afresh upon me. Unction from heaven, come afresh upon me. Yes, Lord, come afresh upon me. Come upon me, Holy Spirit. Let your hand come upon me. Let your hand rest upon me. Let your power rest upon me. Touch me, touch me, touch me, touch me. Touch me, Lord. Touch me, Lord. Touch me, Father. Quicken me, Father. That your name might be glorified. Thank you, Jehovah God. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Open your eyes and look at me. I want to pray. Final prayer. There's nothing that God cannot do. He can make a way for you. I've seen God in so many diverse ways. I went went to graduate school in America without paying in time, they were paying me. I was having more money than my friends who were working. I didn't pay in time. Not a dime. They were paying me. As a student, I was still getting, at that time, 10 years ago, I was still getting 2,800 after tax. And I wasn't paying anything. I wasn't doing anything. My school fees was $65,000 per year. I didn't pay anything. They paid. What can God not do for you? So when God told me that day, when I was fasting and praying back there in Nigeria, and I was saying, God, don't let me go to make a way for me. God said, in Cambridge University. When I went to Cambridge, I didn't go as a student. I went as a professor. Yeah. I went there to give a lead paper. They put me on first class, British Airways. First class, British Airways. Sir, what type of, do we buy Lufthansa? Do we run? That was a time I was dying to go to Cambridge. And I went to Cambridge. I went as a speaker, as a professor. What can God not do for you? He can bring you past all your dreams to make a way for you. So your real problem is not the things that you are pursuing. Your real problem is to pursue intimacy with God. I want to lean on the covenant of the fathers to pray for you today. If there's any need in your life, whether you are believing God for who to marry, we are believing God for the fruit of the womb. There is somebody here, you are believing God for the fruit of the womb, not for you, but for one of your very close relatives. And you are here, you are looking at me right now. I want to say this to you by the word of the Lord. 1, 2, 3, 4 months from now, you will hear good news. And look at me very well. On this same altar, you will come back to testify. There's another person here, you are believing God for a child who has gone wayward. And as I was preaching, you were saying, but this is a child. Look, I'm not as young as you think. But you were saying in your heart, how I wish this boy can be like this. Let me say to you by the word of the Lord, not only will that guy have a turnaround, not only will that child have a turnaround, that child shall come back to the altar. Because it was born and given to at the altar. Right? That child will come back to the altar. In the name of Jesus Christ. There's somebody here, you have an issue that comes and goes. It comes and goes. And it particularly comes back around this time. Once we are entering into winter, that affliction comes back. And you have been nursing some fear in your heart whether or not it will come back. As a matter of fact, you were thinking of saying it recently that you have not seen it, but something made you to say, keep quiet, because it may come. I come here by the word of the Lord today. And the Bible says that the affliction shall not thrice the second time. That which the Lord has delivered you from, you are completely delivered from it. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Anything you are believing God for, I want to put your hand upon your chest. Just pray for 1 minute. And I will go ahead and pray for you. If I mention your situation, just put your hand upon that part of your life. Whether you are believing God for the fruit of the womb, you are believing God for a surgery to be successful, you are believing God, you know, for scholarship, you are believing God for anything, you are believing God for your papers, your application is pending, and you are trusting God that grace will find you. I'd like you to talk to the Almighty God for 1 minute. He's the one who does all things. He's the mighty Almighty. There is nothing He cannot do. He's a gracious God, full of grace and full of mercy, and He's here today to show you mercy. Go ahead, go ahead, go ahead. You are believing God for your husband. Right? Who is an estranged husband? Go ahead, speak to the Lord. Just trust the Lord. Thank you, Jehovah. In Jesus' mighty name, we are prayed. Father, I lift your children into your hand. You are the God of grace. You are the God of mercy. You are the Father of life and the Father of comfort. Lord, I speak to that person, every fear of death in your life, everything that is telling you you may not live long, everything that is even telling you, see who has died, see who has died, and you have been nursing the spirit of death and nursing the fear of death, in the name that is above every other name, I break that yoke in the name of Jesus Christ. I said to you, you will not die, you will live. You will fulfill your purpose. You will fulfill your days. Everything that wants to terminate your life will terminate it. In the name of Jesus Christ. Every sickness, every affliction will terminate it. In the mighty name of Jesus. Every chest problem, every breathing problem, I command you to go and come back no more. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. By the power of endless life, I command every mountain to be destroyed and to disappear. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, every problem in your body, I receive healing for you. From the crown of your head to the sole of your feet, be thou healed from your affliction. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, let the single be happily married. Let the barren conceive and give birth to children. Let there be a word for you. Let there be a breakthrough for you. As you go from me today, you will come back to this same altar. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 days from now, you will come back with a testimony. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, it is well with you. The Lord bless you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you. The Lord give you his peace. The Lord give you grace for divine intimacy. The Lord strengthen his house. The Lord bless Pastor Silver and his wife. The Lord keep them. The Lord enlarge them. The Lord prosper them and make their ministry great. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, I cover you and your family in the blood of Jesus. No coronavirus, no attack upon your life. It is well with you going out. It is well with you coming in. You will not lose your job. Your house will not be foreclosed. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, those of you who have lost your jobs, in the name of Jesus, I prophesy that more doors will be opened unto you. In the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, gracious Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. The greatest thing I can offer to you is for you to know Jesus as your Lord and personal Savior. The first step to intimacy with God is knowing Jesus and receiving him as your Lord and personal Savior. All eyes closed, all head bowed. I pray for you before coming here. Is there anybody here you want to give your life to Jesus? You are not born again. If Jesus should come right now, you know he will not make it to heaven. You have not surrendered your life. And you want to say, my brother, please pray for me. I want to give my life to Christ. Whether I'm online or you are here, I'd like you to raise your hand, right hand to heaven. If there is anybody like that, I want to pray for you. Don't be ashamed. I came here to pray for you, to commit you to the Lord. Anyone like that, if you are yet to give your life to Christ and you want to give your life to Christ, raise your right hand to heaven. I want to pray for you. Okay, if there is nobody like that here, maybe you are online listening to us, I'd like you to put your hand upon your chest and say these prayers with me. Say, Heavenly Father, I come to you today in the name of Jesus. I cannot save myself, but you can save me. Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Forgive me my sins. Make me your own. Make me your daughter. Make me your son. And help me to walk with you all the days of my life. I believe with my heart that Jesus died for me. I confess with my mouth that Jesus is alive because of me. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Blessed be your holy name. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Lord, I pray for all those who said those prayers, that you will establish them to the end and make them useful vessels in your hand to propagate your gospel and to extend your kingdom. Blessed be your name, O God.
In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Thanks for your attention. God bless you.